And I believe. Yeah. the power to heal us, to save us. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. Let us decide and communicate to live our lives for you and only for you, Lord. Give our hearts, give our souls for you. Whatever that means to each of us, let us have the courage and the wisdom to carry on with our daily lives in your love, to give our hearts to you. Whatever we do, whatever we say, whatever we meet, when we eat, when we drink, when we work, when we play, when we raise our kids, let us give our hearts to you, Lord. It is so difficult for us to remember when we live this busy lives. Let us always be daily reminded by your words. And Holy Spirit, please help us. Please work with us, work within us to live the life for you, Lord. We bring our offerings to you, Lord. Please bless our hearts and our offerings, and let it be used to expand your kingdom, your gospel to be spread out, your love to be known to everyone. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Father, thank you for letting us sense your presence this morning through time of praise. Thank you, Lord, for all the people who have created those songs and we can sing together. Thank you for our worship team. Father, we as a congregation want to learn how to worship you. We want to learn how to honor you truly from our hearts. We don't want to just hype up. We don't want to just do it as a routine. But we want to truly have a heart-to-heart connection, eye-to-eye connection with you. And we just want to thank you that this morning we get a chance to worship together as a congregation. Would you just continue as we worship you through the word and announcements and just sharing family stuff, would you just move among us to have a sense of connection with you and also desire connection with one another in deeper ways. Thank you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Good morning, everyone. Great to be with you again. I do have a number of announcements before our speaker comes up and shares the word. So if you will bear with me for a few things. First of all, very important, very important, very, very important. The Philippi basketball team won the tournament last night. Would you give them a big hand? I see that your hips are glued to the seat. It's all right. We still love you. All right. Hey, Well, the other celebration is that we have very special people who have joined us starting from this Sunday, and they are from the youth ministry. They have just had their senior banquet, and they're going to be, you know, it's the first day of joining the EC worship, and we just really, really want to make them feel welcome. So as they stand up, would you give them? Would you give? Please do stand up, because you can't have your seat. Okay, stand up. Would you give them? We just want to really bless them. We're going to have many of them will be able to go to the college retreat that's happening this Wednesday to Friday. Pastor Michelle will be there, and I'm going to be there because I want to just really get to know the college students better through this time, and we're really looking forward to that. We pray. Some have already kind of gone to their trips. Some have gone to Korea and so on. And so sometime as they all come back during the month of June and July, I want to say this in advance. I've said this to already some, but I'm promising for the incoming members, we hope you like it. We are promising a spaghetti dinner at our home for our three guys, and maybe I will make it. We'll see. All right. I'm sharing these announcements because, you know, it just helps us to get connected. Yesterday we had a wonderful time. The Missions Festival. We had over 25 churches from all over this Maryland come, and about 10 or 11 churches came up in succession to share about their church and about their people. You know, we don't know all the numbers, but it was really precious. For example, we had one Japanese church that was in D.C., and their congregation, they said, you know, Sunday congregation, including kids, about 20. And it was really precious for them to share. We had the Iranian church, the Hispanic church, the Nepali church, the Korean church, the multi-ethnic church. It was just a wonderful time. And then we went out and had all these ethnic foods, you know, and I just want to thank so much for everyone who helped make that happen, make all the food, just so thankful. I think it was just a special blessing to see how God was working in so many churches around here. So let's give an applause, a praise to God. Can we do that? All right. And during that time, I met a special two guys, Korean American. One guy actually got saved in the Church of Philippi 25 years ago. And then I got to meet them. And I wanted to meet them because as they came and shared, they were on fire. You could feel the fire in their hearts. And so I wanted to get to know them, and found out one guy, you know, 25 years ago, got saved. And he's gone through a lot of different journeys that radically changed. And so I wanted to get to know them. So they're both pastors now. They had a church plant called New Beginning. And they wanted to share that this June 9th, they wanted to have this event called Healing from the Heart. Basically, they rented out this venue right in Inner Harbor. And they're going to just have all kinds of praise music, and they invited, so they made an announcement to all the ethnic churches, come out with your praise teams, and it's going to be from 3 to 9 o'clock. And we're going to try to meet strangers and say hi, and if those people are willing to be prayed for, we want to pray for them. And so it was really challenging. So I wanted to see what they did. So they said last night, in fact, they go to Baltimore every month, the first Saturday every month, and they go into this place called Helping Up Mission. And I think I vaguely heard this group before, but I didn't know what they did. But they said they're gonna preach the gospel to like 200 people who have come off the streets into this thing. So I wanted to see what it was like. And so I went last night. I kind of canceled all the other stuff that I wanted to, even though it was really busy, I wanted to see what God was doing last night. So I went, it was a little late, and By the time I got there, there were a number of street people up in the front repenting. There were people who were, hugging each other. I was in the back, and then there was a guy who was kind of removed, and I. It turned out he was a Muslim, and so had a little time to share. I just wanted to encourage, those, you guys, Inner Harbor is the tourist capital of the United States, and many people come. I hope that we, that many of us can try to go. So, it was a wonderful time. And I wonder what God has. I know that God has given a heart for us to be involved in Salam Center and so on. So let's see what God will continue to say to us, and let's try to be obedient to what He says. Okay, last but not least, we have a special speaker today. As you know, I said last week, we've been praying for EC Pastor for close to 10 months now. And I won't go through all the different meetings that we had and calls and so on with other people, but finally we found we God kind of helped us meet a couple that we just really sense could fit with our church, and so we've invited them. And I'm gonna give you a little bio or a little bit of CV stuff. All right. I don't usually do this, but education wise, he has a PhD in educational studies in Trinity Evangelical Divinity School. His dissertation is on perceptions of working relationship among multicultural team members in international mission agencies, Lengua Cultural Analysis. That's a pretty long title. I don't know if you understood that. But it has a lot to do with multicultural perception. You know, we are in a place with many different cultures. Why did he write a thesis like that, a dissertation like that? He has a 20-year career in Bible translation with Wycliffe, church planting, discipleship, and equipping cross-cultural workers, with particular expertise in leadership development, multicultural team building, dialogical education, institutional planning, result-based management, language and culture acquisition. I won't read all of it. That's just half of the paragraph there. He's got many distinguished honors and awards. He was in Azerbaijan for many years. And he is involved in many different organizations. He's also adjunct faculty. He's been an adjunct faculty in Tyndale University College and Seminary. He's been a project coordinator and Bible translator for Summer Institute of Linguistics. He's been a youth and college pastor in a Korean American church up in Toronto. Like I said, I don't usually do this, but it's part of his journey, it's how God has shaped him. But more than that, the last part is a personal part. The personal part is that I didn't know him before, but we had a Skype talk, and as we were talking about how God, I was introducing myself and how God has shaped me, and he was sharing him, and there was a really sense of heart connection. Many of the lessons we have learned in the past, I don't know, 5 to 10 years, there seems to be a sync with that. And so, and he's got a real pastoral heart and all of that. His wife, Bonnie, has a master's in counseling, and she actually has been counseling teenagers who are going through a lot of depression and things like that, and do a lot of premarital counseling. And so I'm really excited to introduce to you and submit to you Pastor Jonathan Kim. Would you give him a warm Philippi welcome?
Good morning. I did not expect that Pastor David actually read through part of my CD. Caught me by surprise. Thank you for a warm welcoming. As I prepare, my wife and I, as we prepare for this trip, we kind of heard what's happening in this area, namely flooding in Ellicott City. And I watched the video, and it was kind of scary. So I was praying that in Hanover, you guys are okay, and kind of asking. And I was told by Pastor David that some of the members of Philippi Church have been affected by it. I hope and pray that you guys are okay, because I personally had an experience in Toronto area a number of years ago. My our basement got flooded up to a new level. It wasn't fun at all. So, we are living in a society in which people are bombarded with long hours of work and stress, and anxiety and uncertainty. As Pastor David mentioned, my wife is a professional counselor, what they call registered psychotherapist. Though she may not, I mean, she shouldn't share who, I have no way of identifying who she's talking about. We often talk the nature of the problem that she encounters. I mean, the world is so broken. I don't even have to mention that to you. For a person like me who's visiting in a short while, like this, I'm very kind of an awkward situation because I don't know you personally. I wish I could, but there's no way. I really don't know every one of you, or most of you. But I know that many of you, if not all of you, may be going through some kind of challenges or difficulties in your life. One of the church members back in my hometown told me that he's working 80 hours per week at an accounting firm. Does this sound familiar? I mean, 80 hours, it's kind of double full-time. People working at other corporate firms say the same thing about overworking. And I heard students complaining about the teacher going too fast without accommodating their own pace. Some of the high school students have graduated and joining and getting ready to go to college. I was taking my son, who's now in university, during the fresh orientation week for our son, I heard a professor saying, quote, "You guys worked hard to get in here, but you will have to work harder to get out." Is this supposed to be an encouragement or what? My son already felt during the first week behind, even as he went through the orientation week. I'm not saying this to discourage you guys, just to serve the reality. Stop yelling, tough word out there. Sadly, that particular university faces students' suicides almost every year. It's one of the major universities in Canada. Further, reading newspaper, again one of the newspapers back in my town, Toronto Star, just last year, the headline goes like this: "Almost half of Ontario youth miss school because of anxiety." Study suggests. That's the title. And this little study found among 18 to 34 year old people across the province, 46% had missed school due to issues related to anxiety. And 40% had sought mental health help. Of those, 50% found the experience of getting help challenging. 42% did not get the help they needed or are still waiting. Wow, that's from my hometown. But what about here in the States? Guess what? Well, CNBC headline just last year, as I did some little bit of surveying research, the title headlines on CNBC: "Most American workers are stressed most of the time." That's the title of CNBC just last year, about a year ago. Just to quote, I'm quoting their article, just one paragraph: Our modern culture of overwork seems to have reached new heights. Even though we know that stress, especially chronic stress, is really bad for us, many of us still subconsciously ascribe to societal ideas that tells us that being quote unquote so busy and having little time for anything but work is normal or even good. Now, new research confirms what we already guessed. Most American workers are stressed. In a meeting with one of my deacons back in my church, as part of what I normally do, the activities that I normally do, I just want to get together and just chill. Just over coffee and lunch table. And just get to know each other. I have no other agenda than getting to know that person. Not far into our conversation, I found he was very defensive at first because he sees me as a ministerial pastor, maybe with some kind of job to do, and he was expecting me to give him more stuff to do in his plate. So he was very defensive. And I realized, hold on, I'm interested in you. I have no agenda here but to get to know you. So halfway into our conversation, I realized that this particular person has been serving the church during our school 5 years, and he's burnt out. And there's no, he felt like he's spent. So that when he sees me, somebody like me, he was kind of defensive. Okay, what is he going to say that to me again? You know, more work? It was a really sad encounter, and of course the conversation carried on, and we said, well, you and I, we just get together on a regular basis and have lunch together, and that's it. That's all we need. And he was kind of laughing about it. So, life is full of challenges and problems. One of my favorite authors, Scott Peck, in his book, Road Less Traveled, it's kind of old book, if you're not familiar with that book, it's okay, says, he begins that book, Road Less Traveled, life is difficult. Now, we don't need Scott Peck to say life is difficult. Everybody already knows it. Everybody already knows life is difficult. Most of us, if not all of us, have our own problems and challenges to solve. Yet, confronting and solving problems can be a painful process, which many people attempt to avoid. I cannot possibly list all the problems you may face or you may have been encountering. How about family issues, finances, career choice, dating, switching a major, driving to school, having trouble with co-workers, or going through a career transition? There are so much to learn, so much to handle, and so much to explore, so much to take care of. One study suggests by the year 2020 or 2025, 80% of job world in 2025 is not existing here right now. But that means is whatever study or job or professional career you may be involved right now, in say 5 years down the road, we all may have to learn one way or another. So we are facing tremendous uncertainty. How? Having said that, how do all these challenges we face, you know, I face in life, have to do with our belief in God, our faith in Jesus? How do you see God? I'm asking you, Jeremy, how do you see God involving in your life? Surely, you believe in God, we all believe in God, and yet, in your deepest heart, do you believe that your God is too far away from you, that he doesn't really care about what you're interested in or concerned about? is that where we are. In today's passage, we see an invitation from Jesus for those who are weary. This invitation is definitely the most important invitation that anyone can ever receive in her lifetime. However, this invitation is not just for the weary to get rest, as traditionally understood. It is an invitation to a way of life, godly way of living a life as God intended it to be. In order to understand what this invitation is about, we're going to go through who is the one that did the invitation, who invited us, and what is our privilege, and how should we then respond to that? What's our responsibility? Let's go over first one. Who is the one that invited us? Knowing who Jesus is. I remember back in my Trinity days, when all my family members, we have three children, they are all grown up. Well, our last one is in grade 11, so he has one more high school to go. But then, I'm talking about 4 or 5 years ago, all of us, we are full-time students. Someone told me that there are people who have time, but no money, so that they can't enjoy life. There are people who have money, but no time, so that there is no rest for them. All of us, being full-time students, meant we had no time, no money. We are miserable. When we are exhausted, weary, and even depressed at times, telling us to get some rest did not help us at all. We knew we needed to get some rest. Oftentimes though, it seemed impossible to get some rest while I felt like being buried in books, papers, and articles and other life's demands. We just did not have means to get some rest. When a friend of ours said to us, get some rest, it was not helpful, though it was well-meaning and, of course, caring word. In fact, it sounded like an empty word, since we did not see how resting could happen. So, when Jesus invites us to give us rest, it's not like giving an empty word with good intention and yet without means to make it happen. It's not that kind of invitation. So who is the one who invites us to come to him? In verse 27, the passage that we just read gives us the basis, foundation for his invitation. It gives us authority as to who is this person who invites us. And verse 27 says, all things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. This is the proof of who he is, someone who is able to do what he said he would. It is only Jesus who has access to the Father and the resources of the Father. Colossians chapter 1, 15 to 17 says, I'm reading Colossians chapter 1, 15 to 17. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. I'm going to just animate a little bit to emphasize all, everything I see. For in him, all things were created. Things in heaven and on earth. Visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things. And in him, all things were together. Psalm 139, my favorite psalms. I used to memorize entire psalm, but I, of course, forget many of them. But Psalm 139, 13, 15 says, for you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. The one who invites us, you and me, knows you better than four letters of MBTI can explain, or nine types of Enneagram can reveal. I'm not sure if you're familiar with Enneagram, but it says, reformer, helper, achiever, individualist, investigator, loyalist, enthusiast, challenger, and peacemaker, and there's more. There's like a strength finder, and there's like some, you know, categories that try to understand you, try to understand you. God, who made you, who formed you, who needed you together in your mother's womb, knows better than any of the tools available out there, the latest information or knowledge, technology can find. Jesus knows your thought even before you utter your thought. He even counts your hair, and yet he does not slumber to watch over you. Jesus is someone who is worthy of our lifelong allegiance, who can restore shalom. I love that shalom. Shalom. I'm going to repeat that throughout my remainder of message. Shalom is the way things ought to be, the way things meant to be, the way God intended it to be. So, you and I, we have a privilege of responding to that invitation from the Creator of the universe, your Maker, our Maker, to give us rest. It's not an empty word. Jesus is the one who's able to do what he has promised. He is gentle and humble. How do we know he's gentle and humble? Isaiah 53:2 says, he grew up before him like a tender tree, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we would desire him. He's not a Hollywood celebrity. There's no flesh, there's no performance, there's no splendor. When we think about Jesus, he's just a normal guy who looked very ordinary. In fact, Bible says there's no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Christianity is not about a whole bunch of do's and don'ts. People are burdened by the external religious do's and don'ts, religious laws and customs. What Jesus offers here is an invitation. It's an invitation not to religious laws, regulations, empty rituals or formalities, but a way of life. Yoke is a way of life characterized by gentleness and humility. He is capable, non-threatening, and approachable. So, knowing that, knowing who is the one that invited us, how are we going to respond to that? What's our responsibility? Along with the privilege, we have responsibility of entering into that relationship we call discipleship. Discipleship is a relationship between learner and the teacher. A disciple is a learner. Who is our teacher then? Jesus. Entering into this kind of relationship with Jesus is what we miss in our Christian life. Again, one of my favorite authors, Dallas Willard, calls it the missing in his book, Great Commission, Great Commission, the title. He calls it greater mission. In this relationship with the Master, we enter into a new life of learning to restore shalom, the way things ought to be, the way God designed it to be, what was beautiful and perfect. That's why we can respond to that. In this relationship with the Master, we enter into that relationship the way things ought to be, because the way things ought to be is kind of broken because of sin, and it became not the way it's supposed to be. It is in this context that Jesus invited you and me to do what? He asked us to learn from him. Jesus says his yoke is easy and his burden is light. Not because that relationship he invites us to enter into is easy or light, but because of the new birth in Jesus, new way of life that he offers, and the teaching we receive from the Master. The way of life is ongoing, dynamic, and comprehensive. So we have responsibility for entering into that learner and teacher relationship with the Master. Then, what do we learn from him? Again, going back to Colossians, all things have been created through him and for him. When you read in the scripture, all things, don't that all things include the way things ought to be in all areas of our lives? If we truly look at the problems and challenges we face every day, and trust that our Master can guide us to shalom, the way things ought to be, doesn't Jesus ask us to learn not only how to pray in the reading of the Bible passages, but also how to do research and development in any field, in engineering field and sciences, do accounting, and study medical sciences? Doesn't he also want us to learn from the Master in mathematics, business administration, and politics, dealing with family matters, or career challenges, and so on? When I was conducting a research for my dissertation in the Caucasus, I interviewed about 30 participants. I was unsure about halfway through whether I was on the right track or not. We call it imposter syndrome. Do I have what it takes? It's kind of self-doubt. Okay, I had mapped out what I was supposed to do, and I was carefully executing what I was supposed to do. But I had this self-doubt. Oh, God. Am I on the right track? Do I have what it takes to push through this? I was in the middle of that self-doubt stage, and a friend of mine reminded me of the greatest help that I could have. Can anybody guess? The guidance of the Holy Spirit. Could the Holy Spirit guide me to do my research as best as I could? What do you think? When I was in Bible translation, many of us were reminded, even the most competent linguists and Bible scholars would constantly look to God for his help and guidance. Without that, it's simply impossible to carry out the task. It was certainly true when I was dealing with the alphabet making process in this particular language, utterly discouraged and frustrated with my language learning process and the analysis of the language. I constantly prayed to God for his help and guidance to learn what I could not. After all, who is the greatest linguist? Who is the greatest accountant, business person, leader, manager, physician, pharmacist, mathematician, engineer, designer, and computer programmer? The list goes on. To a struggling daughter with algebra, I said, ask Jesus to help you. Of course, there's a Khan Academy, there's a Purple Math, but ask Jesus to help you learn from the Master. When we sent up our son to that university that I talked about, not far from Toronto, studying engineering, I said, I didn't say son, but Jeremy, you are not going to invent anything that God has not already created. You are only discovering what God has already made. Ask Jesus to help you discover, because He is the greatest engineer. Friends, dear sisters and brothers, we are not a bunch of religious people to go through rituals every Sunday without any thoughts to our minds. We are followers of Jesus. Jesus is inviting you and me to a faith journey that cannot be contained in Sunday worship practice or any other discipleship programs. He's inviting you and me to a different kind of lifestyle, a new way of life, and a rhythm of life. And He promises to give us rest. Rest is not a withdrawal from work. Rather, it is proactively engaging with the life giver in learner and teacher relationships. Enjoy the privilege of having direct access to the Master and keep the responsibility of entering into a lifelong relationship of being a learner. You will find rest in Him. On the road to Emmaus, Jesus came alongside His disciples. This is after death and resurrection. And these disciples didn't quite know what happened after death. They were discouraged. They were heavy laden. And Jesus came alongside with them, walked with them, dialogued with them. And His disciples learned from their masters. And as a result, dear saints, aren't our hearts burning? That invitation for you and me, when we respond to Him, encounter with Him, the Master, He can transform our burdened hearts to burning hearts. It's that kind of invitation. Are you tired? Are you weary? Are you stressed out for whatever reason? I know some of the context that you may have gone through or you went through this past year. I don't know a whole lot of detail, God knows. But I know that many of you, many of us, we may have been wounded. What did you do? Jesus is inviting you to come to Him and learn from Him. Are you carrying a heavy burden? Hear the Master's voice inviting you to come and learn from Him. Wrestle with Him. He's able to handle you. Ask Him challenging questions. He's not going to be shocked by your questions. Dialogue with Him. He will be a source of joy in your soul. I'm going to close my message with a quote from the Message by Eugene Peterson, one of my favorite translations. Are you tired, worn out, burnt out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me, and you will recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me. Work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you will learn to live freely and lively. How would you respond to that invitation? Father God, it's easy for us. for those of us who are so familiar with what may be called religious jargon or cliche. Oh Jesus, yes, we go to Him and you give us rest. We are not about that. We are not about uttering religious jargon or cliche. We are about learning community, followers of Jesus. And that journey is lifelong. And the journey is not dependent upon sight. Because faith is not opposed to knowledge, it is opposed to sight. We know who called us. We want to respond to that God. Would you nudge our hearts through your Holy Spirit, Father? Speak to us. Open our closed hearts once again. Father God, if we have to, help us to pick up the pieces and move on with the renewed vision and renewed dream, that we can enter into that relationship, lifelong relationship of learning from the Master. We may not be able to see it, but God, that's the whole point. We are not asked to see it. Our faith is not by sight, but by faith. We know Jesus is with us. We know we can dialogue. We know we can converse with you. Would you constantly teach us as we enter into that relationship that is ongoing, that is communal, that is lifelong, God. And then we'll face, we'll enjoy the rest, the real rest that only you can give us.
Speak the rest of the day, inviting us
inviting us into your presence. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love, incredible love of God the Father, the fellowship, the empowerment, the continuing leading of the Holy Spirit be upon all of us this day and evermore. All God's people said, Amen.
Amen.